I greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and again welcome you to this morning service. Surely the Lord would make this service a great blessing for every one of us. If you've got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We shall read verses 3, 4 and 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, from verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. We do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Our weapons are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. And bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. The caption for this morning meditation is, Our Battlefield. The warfare in which a Christian is engaged, is against sin, against idolatry, against every form of evil. Every Christian is a soldier. Every Christian is engaged in a warfare in which he has to fight against sin, wrong worships, and every form of evil. He is a soldier enlisted under the banner of the Redeemer. To oppose and resist all forms of evil. A Christian servant of God, a believer, a faithful, he is engaged in resisting, opposing all forms of evil. We are going to battle to fight against. Our battle is not against flesh and blood. We have got an enemy. Our enemy is real. Many times I told you. We meditate on that. And the Bible describes our enemy as a king. The Bible describes our enemy as a god, as a prince, as a ruler. Our enemy has got his own dominion. He has got his army. And he has got his own stratagems. Our enemy is real. We must know the power of our enemy. We are not fighting against flesh and blood. We are not fighting against human beings. Your problem is not from human beings. It's not from your neighbor. It's not from your boss. It's not from your worker. It's not from the maid in the house. Your problem is not from your mother-in-law or your daughter-in-law. It's not your father, your mother, or your brother, your sister. Your problem is not a man. Your problem is the power of darkness, the principality, the powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, and the spiritual wickedness in the heavenlies. We are going to warfare to fight against them. My dear brother, my dear sister, allow to give you a few points. We have to fight against our own flesh, our ego. We know who we are. I know that I am the pastor. I'm in charge for this church. When I go elsewhere, there I may be a guest. I'm not worried whether the mic is on or not, whether the musicians are present or not, whether they take the video or not. There I'm not worried. Why I'm worried? Why I'm upset? Here I am the pastor. The Lord has given me this ministry. We got every area. You know that you are the wife. You know that you are husband. You know that you have what you have studied. You know that you are a postgraduate. You know that your father was rich. Ego is we know who we are. Ego is we know who we are. The problem is we know who we are. Who we are. The husband says, I am the husband. I am the husband. The father says, see, I am the father says. I am the father. I am the boss. That's we have to fight against that ego. We have got many problems because we know who we are. It doesn't mean that we have to forget who we are. My dear brother, my dear sister, that ego is crucified. That ego is nullified. That ego is become inactive. I know that I am the husband. I know that I have studied under Gamaliel. I know that I got no sin. No offense according to the law of the land. I know that I was a Pharisee. But that's rubbish. That's rubbish. That's not going to help me. That's not going to help me. He made that dung. It's a waste. It's disadvantageous. I know that I have 3 degrees. It's disadvantageous. But I cannot forget it. I should make it inactive. I have to fight against self. This old man, the man in me is 6,000 years old. Don't think that you are only 30 years old or 13 years old or 20 years old or 60 years old. The real man in you is 6,000 years old. You've got a rich heritage, strong heritage of the world in you. There is a system. Husband is the head. Husband is the head. It's a system. The desire of the wife will be upon her husband. Many a time we exert this. The husband is the head. It said in the Garden of Eden, God told you are the head. Your husband is the head. And God told Eve, your desire will be upon your husband. Brother, sister, God did say that. But you know that? You know that? The husband is the head, the desire of the wife will be upon her husband. It's a curse on the mankind. When God was pronouncing his curse on the mankind, he said. When God created Adam and Eve, before they sinned, God never said husband is the head. God never said your desire will be upon your husband. When Asevanai Pattikollum, you know what is the result of that? After a few verses you read, the desire of Cain was on the Abel. Kainudaiya aasai Abelai pattikondirundathu. Because of the desire of Cain on Abel, what was the result? Cain killed Abel. Cain killed Abel. The desire of the wife upon the husband is a curse. Love is different. Love is different. Obeying the husband is different. So 6,000 years these things are in us. I am the head. I'll have dominion. You should obey me. I am the wife. My dear brother, my dear sister. It's a very dramatic change. Jesus said, if you want to be the head, you should be the servant. World cannot accept it. If I want to be the head, should I be the servant? Is it a new theory? That's why I say we are fighting against our own ego. We are fighting against our own ego. We know who we are. We have to fight against that. Number two, our flesh, our physical system, it's weak. It's weak. We have to fight against our own flesh. The spirit quickeneth. Spirit is strong. We have to fight against our own weakness. And we have to fight against the world. This world is also 6,000 years old. When you want to go for the full-time ministry, your relatives will tell you, your friends will tell you, nonsense. You can serve the Lord. They'll say, so see and see. As a bank officer, what a mighty ministry he did. Why should you want to resign your job and go? As a bank officer, he was able to do such a mighty ministry. You need not resign your job and go. See that businessman. He has got his own business. And you see what ministry he is doing, what television program he has got. Are they fools? The world will tell you. Your wife will tell you. Your friends will tell you. Pastors will tell you. They'll discourage you from taking a decision. The world will beg you. You have to fight against that. We have to fight against that. They've got a number of examples. I'll explain that later. Number three. You have to fight. Number four. You have to fight against devil. His principalities. His powers. His powers of darkness. The spiritual wickedness in the heavenlies. We have to fight against. The last week we saw about this. The powers of darkness, the devil. So we have to fight against our ego. We have to fight against our physical weaknesses, our flesh. And we have to fight against the world and the systems of the world. We have to fight against the devil, its principalities, powers. We have to fight against them. My dear brother, my dear sister, in this series, we are going to see today the battleground, the battlefield, not only our enemy. We are going to see the battlefield. This is the battlefield in which we have to fight. This terrain is not earthly, is not physical, geographical. Because when you fight the battle, certain battles, you have to use navy, naval force, seafare. It's a seafare. It's a naval force we have to employ. At times it should be air force. At times the military. There are different regimes. The soldiers who can fight the guerrilla warfare in jungle. It's a jungle. Then you have to be trained to fight on mountains. Or you may have to cross rivers. There will be crocodiles. Or there may be fortified cities. You may not know what is inside. You may not be able to penetrate through. So it's not just one type of warfare. You must be trained for guerrilla warfare. There may be a naval force, a air force. Similarly, we must understand our battleground. We read in these verses 4, 5 and 6. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God. God willing, about our weapons of warfare, that's very, very important. We'll have it some other time. Maybe in the next message. Weapons of warfare. Before we could understand the weapons of warfare, because the weapons of warfare is very, very essential. What do you mean by the weapons of warfare? The means by which we hope to achieve our victory. We use these weapons, the means with which we hope to achieve our victory. We shall meditate upon this later. Today we are meditating, we are concentrating on the battlefield. Four types of battlefield I want to show you. I love that you could make a note of these things. Are you ready with your pen, paper, pad or tablet? Verse 4, we'll go to verse 4 again. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God. Number 1, to the pulling down of strongholds. Strongholds. Pulling down of strongholds. Number 2, verse 5. Casting down imaginations. Casting down imaginations. Battlefield number 2. Number 3, verse 5. Casting down every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. Number 3, every high thing that exalteth against the knowledge of God. Number 4, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Number 4, every thought of disobedience. Every thought of disobedience of Christ. So here I want to show you, it's like a picture. In the battlefield, the first one we have to pull down, raise it to the ground, pull down. Unless you pull down that stronghold, you cannot go forward. Jericho wall should fall. How could we do that? We'll have it another message. But I want you to have the picture that there are some strongholds. So number 1, strongholds. But what do we mean by these strongholds? I'd love to show you the Greek word what Paul was using so that you could understand. Vukroma, vukroma. You can transliterate. O-C-H-U, voku, voku, roma, R-O-M-A, vukroma. What do you mean by that vukroma? This vukroma is a very simple Greek word fastening together. Iruga padikkiru is a TVS fastness where they make the nuts and the bolts and the rivets fastening. We say steadfast. Fast means it's not only speed. That word fastening means tightening. Tightening. With there's a nut and bolt, we are tightening, steadfast, urudi, irukam. So that okuroma means, the simple meaning of that word is fastening. Fastening. My dear brother, my dear sister, it is fortification. In Tamil, romba valu uttapadrudu. Make it very strong. Make it very strong. That's what we read in English. That word English is very beautiful. Strong hold. Strong hold is a compound word. Strong. Very strong. Hold, holding together. Strong hold means holding together strongly. So they got a fort. Stone after stone, 100 feet wide, and concreted well, made it very strong. Even cannonballs cannot demolish them. The fort of Jericho was a stronghold, 300 feet high, 300 feet high. Their building is about 9 feet. Just imagine a 30-story building, a 10-story building. It's about 100 feet. A 30-story building About 300 feet. More than that. More than a 30-story building. That high. And the thickness of that wall, generally the thickness of this wall was 9 inches. 3/4 of a feet. 3/4 of a feet. 9 inches. Less than 1 foot. But that wall was 100 feet thick. This hall is only 70 feet. That wall was thicker than this hall. That's a strong hold. 300 feet high, 100 feet wide. That was the wall of Jericho. It's not that easy to break that down. It's a strong hold. So Paul says, when you want to do your battle, your enemy, he is in a strong hold. So I just give you a few illustrations to make that clear. What are those strongholds that you have to fight against? So the sins of the heart. The sins of the heart are fortified by being indulgence and by the hold which they have on the soul. It has got a very strong hold, sin. Say for some people, lying, just it will come in their mouth. It's very strong. They don't even think it is wrong. They may be Pentecostals. This is another power of darkness. They don't know it is lie. They think it's human wisdom. Suppose, as I said many a time, just give a small illustration. When you are sitting and talking with your husband at the dining table, you are talking about a particular auntie. You say that, "I don't like that auntie at all. Really, I cannot pass. She is a very bad woman. She is very boring. Mukka blade." You are talking about that auntie. And the doorbell rings. That auntie comes. As soon as you see that auntie, you say, "Oh, praise Lord, praise Lord. We are just talking about you only. What a joy it is seeing you." Liar! Liar! You will go to the hellfire. Just a few seconds before you said you don't like to see her. Next second you are saying how you are very glad to see her. All liars will go to hell. All liars will go to hell. You go to somebody's house. They give you a cup of coffee. You don't like the taste at all. And they come and ask you, "How is this coffee?" "Oh, it's nice, very nice." When you come out, you tell somebody, "Kalni thanni maari irundhuchu, idho or coffee." But you don't think it is wrong. Because it is 6,000 years strong. You're seeing your grandpa talking like that. You're seeing your grandma talking like that. You're seeing your papa talking like that. You're seeing your mom talking like that. You're seeing the world talking like that. You have learnt it from your cradle. You have learnt it from your cradle. Now today you have to fight against it. Today you have to fight against it. So sin is not only drinking liquor. Small lies. Spontaneously. We are born with that. We are born with that. It's not that easy to break down. It's very strong. And the power of darkness, we may not know that is wrong. We may not know that is wrong. It's in our system. My dear brother, my dear sister, at times it's very difficult to break down because it's inbuilt with our system. Certain habits, A stronghold. It has got a hold on you. Let come what may. Even a bulldozer cannot break it down. I love to show you one Bible verse. Jeremiah 13:23. If you got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Jeremiah 13:23. Can the Ethiopian change his skin? Can the Ethiopian change his skin? Or the leper his spots? Born with them. Can the leper his spots? Then may he also do good. If that is so, you can also do good. You cannot do good. You cannot change. It is born with you. It is born with you. It's not that easy to change. That's a stronghold. 100 feet thick. Just somebody cannot just pull it down. You cannot pull it down. You cannot pull it down. Then may you also do good that are accustomed to do evil. How powerful it is. You got accustomed to do evil. To do evil. It is not that easy to change. It's a very, very stronghold. From my experience, I love to tell you one thing. What Pastor, again, I'm sorry. Many times I heard that you people are preaching or giving a testimony or something. You always say, our pastor said. I am not an exceptionist. So what all I have to say, my pastor said. There's a time that I came for the ministry. One of the assignments given to conduct Saturday fasting prayer for the workers, mostly the workers of ACA, Saturday prayer. The prayer used to be from 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock. From 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock, that prayer, 3 hours. So very dutifully, we all from the secular field, so very dutifully I was going for the prayer at 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock I would be the lonely person, maybe 1, 2, 3 they will be coming. By the time 10:30 the crowd will be there. One day when I was conducting the prayer meeting, sister, an auntie was coming from Annanagar. I just started prayer at 10:30. She just rushed in. And she said, Pastorya, na kudumi manichikonga. Pastorya, na kudumi manichikonga. What she meant, she's got a big family. She has to do every work for the children, grandchildren, and she has to rush for the prayer. So she said, Pastor, now or kudumi manichikonga. By the time she could finish, another brother is a bachelor. He was staying in the prayer house. We all call him lovingly doctor. He was staying in the prayer house. This auntie said, I am a kudumi manichikonga. She knelt down. I still remember, it's still a picture in my eye. This brother, doctor, he was keeping his Bible like this, putting on his jibba buttons. He was coming up. Pastoraya, na or thani katta manichikonga. He said, I am a thani katta manichikonga. There is nobody to help me. So I have to do all my work and come for the prayer. Thani katta manichikonga. Kudumi is also late. Thani katta is also late. So it's only a system. They got accustomed to be late. So I went and told Pastor. Pastor, by 10:30 everybody is coming. Why should we fix it at 10 o'clock? And then we say everybody is coming late. And I have to finish the prayer at 1 o'clock. So everybody has agreed. We'll start at 10:30. We finish at 1:30. Ray Patsh, he looked at me. You know, Thambi Rabi knows the way he gazes. 10:30 vandruvaangala? Everybody said they'd come, Pastor. Okay. Next week, 10:30 I went there. 10:30 I went there. Again I was low. 10:45, 11, 11:15. Prayer was over. I came down. Pastor Sundaram said, 10:30 ke ethana per vandanga. I was standing like this. I remember it. You know what Pastor Sundaram said? Experience venum. Anubhavam pathadhu. Inna varaiku enak anubhavam pathala. Even when we change, keep the time 6 o'clock, those who are late would be late. You change the time 8 o'clock, those who are late would be late. They got accustomed to it. Can we change the skin of an Ethiopian? No, it's not possible. Can we change the spots of a leper? It's not possible. If that can be done, you can learn to do good. But you got accustomed to do evil. Certain practices are very strong. In English they say in time, on time, out time. Those who are in time, always in time. It's not the distance. This morning by 7:30, somebody is coming from Thirunindavu. They were here at 7:30. So it's not the distance. When it was 6 o'clock, again from Thirunindavu, they'd be here by 5:35, 45. It is a system. They got accustomed to that. In time. There are some people on time, always rushing on the time. The people from Thambaram, Velachery, they are here at before 8 o'clock. They are here before 8 o'clock. It's not the distance, it's not the age. It's not any inconvenience. It is how we got accustomed to it. We got accustomed to it. There may be certain situations that would fight against our nature. But we have to fight against our nature. We have to pull down these strongholds. It's not only smoking, it's not only liquor. Very strong. Very strong. We have to pull them down. In God's business, in your personal life, in your education, in every area, in planning, in scheming, you could be successful. You have to pull down the strongholds. You should not allow these things to be very strong. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's not just to hurt anybody, but I want to tell you. You got accustomed to. You just go home and read that verse from Jeremiah 13. They got accustomed to do that is wrong. Accustomed to come late. Accustomed to procrastinate. You go to somebody, I'll do it tomorrow. I'll say phone later. I'll do afterwards. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it next week. Always they procrastinate. If Ethiopian can change his skin, the leopard can change his spots, these people can also change their lifestyle. I'll do homework later. This can be seen in your childhood. In Tamil there is a saying, Nagathala pudingi podradha vittutingana per kodari eduthu vettanum. Doing things in time, it came to me when I was in the school. When there is a holiday homework, the examination is over, the holiday homework, the same speed I'll finish the holiday homework and throw it away. I enjoy the whole vacation. I'll enjoy the whole vacation. There are children. I'll do it afterwards. I'll do it after 10 days. I'll do it after 1 month. There's 2 months holiday. I can do it later. 2 days before you. I have to do my homework. I have to do my holiday work. I have to do my holiday work. The day, reopening day. No, I don't want to go to school. They are accustomed to procrastination. These are habit formations. As a teacher, when the examination is over, that afternoon when I get my paper, in that afternoon I would start correcting those papers. Because I want to have the rest of the days for my ministry. Planning. You know, to speak about myself. You get accustomed. These are the strongholds. You can't have victory over Satan. The powers of darkness. unless you are willing to pull down these strongholds. My dear brother, my dear sister, I got a number of things to share with you, and I want to finish it a little later. The sins of the heart, not only that, the wickedness of the world, which we oppose, is strongly fortified. The fashions of the world, we don't want to change. This is the system of the world. Everybody is doing like this. The peer pressures, the human passions, the passion of the mother. Let the child enjoy. They get a passion. So we all, when the Lord spoke to me, I removed my jewels. Let the child enjoy. When the Lord speaks, let the child remove. Then the argument comes. So I was also going to movie and all when I was a young person. Now I was a poor child. He wants to go to a movie. Let her go to a movie. When the Lord speaks, you will change. When I was young, I was in adultery. I had with many boys, many girls. Now let the child, poor child. When the Lord speaks, she will change. The systems of the world, very strong. The passions, mad love for children, mad love for husband, wife, our own people, are very strong. Unless we break down, pull down, pulling down the stronghold, the 100 feet thick. You got that accustomed till from your childhood. You are unable to change it. As I said earlier, 6 o'clock, 10 minutes late. 8 o'clock, 10 minutes late. Okay, 8:30, 10 minutes late. Accustomed to that. I'm not blaming anybody, I'm just telling you the truth. Unless you are willing to pull down these strongholds, they are very strong in your life. I can give you a number of things. The one point strengthens another. When philosophers say, how the stronghold, one stone upon the other, one stone upon the other. Now how it happened, just I go back to this late coming. Earlier, 6 o'clock, you want to go back, go to bed earlier. Now it is only 8 o'clock, so you push your going back to bed late. So you got up at 4 o'clock to be here at 6 o'clock. Now you push it to 6 o'clock, so that you can be here at 8 o'clock. So how these strongholds are built is a very philosophic truth, one stone upon the other, one reason upon the other, one habit upon the other. It doesn't come just zee boomba. You've got passions. Okay, I'm weak, I'm sickly. My dear brother, my dear sister, for the glory of the Lord, I am saying, if we give passions, passion for our child, or passion for ourselves, we cannot do what we are doing. For the last 15-20 days, Anand was in the ministry in different places, in difficult terrains, in Assam, in Orissa, in difficult terrains, not to praise anybody, I'm just telling you. We have to fight against our flesh. Only this morning he came, isn't it? This morning he came from, how many days, isn't it? 15 days. 18 days of hectic tour. This morning, Anand reached Chennai, Anand is in the service. If he wants to give one reason, I am 70 plus, I have 18 days ministry, I am weak, stone upon stone, stone upon stone, your negativity would become stronger. We all are fighting against it. I know how sick sister was, not to praise them, just I want to encourage the young people here. Yesterday was a hectic time, she was lying down, getting up, too weak to do anything. Early morning, 3 o'clock. She was to prepare the love feast, the Lord's Supper. 3 o'clock. She is here. If you got reasons why you want to be negative, You can never pull down the strongholds. Yesterday I came here to prepare the message. When I came here, a lot of things to attend. So I told Thambi Rabi, "Ayyo, na ini Saturday inga varave maten." I had to fight against it. It's not that easy, brother, sister. We have got stone upon stone. The great numbers are united. The strongholds are built because of great numbers. It's not one stone upon one stone. You've got a great numbers of stone, great numbers of experience. For years and years, years and years you are doing that. As I said, 6,000 years you are doing that. 6,000 years of life, 6,000 years of passion, 6,000 years of perceptions. You are not 13 years old. The inner man in you is 6,000 years old. That's a system. That's a blood. My dear brother, my dear sister, you take the idolatry. Very strong. You take the Roman Catholics, the Hindus, even the many of the CSA Christians, even today the Pentecostal Christians. They are unable to come out of that cross. They are unable to come out of that image. They are unable to throw out that image. It's very strong. Their system will support them. There's nothing wrong in it. When you go to a new house, you just keep a cross. That's very strong. We have to do that. That cross must be there. For them, that spear must be there. Or that image must be there. Very strong, or at least a Jesus picture. If there's nothing, at least a Bible. So the idolatry, having an idol as a symbol of the presence of God, is very strong. We are unable to come out of that. We are unable to come out of that. I can go on and on and on. Brother, sister, we have to fight against these things. These are the strongholds, fastening. The word means fastening together, very strong. Irukkamal. Nama sister thoda ottikittu irukku. Nama lifestyle oda ottikittu irukku. It's not that easy. It's not that easy unless somewhere you pull down the strongholds. You are stupid, decisive. Paul says, we are pulling down the strongholds, the opinions of the world. They are the strongholds. I got a lot of things, the arguments of the world. The whole world is very strong against us. Against the principles of the Bible. Against any good thing. Against any good thing. We have got a nature to love evil. We have got a nature. We may have a nature to lie down more. We may have a nature going late. We may have a nature to speak a lie. That's our nature. We are fighting. I have to fight against it. I have to fight against it. My dear brother, my dear sister. After a long time, my grandchildren came. I can just play with them. I love to play with them. I have to fight against it. I have to prepare this message. I have to spend Saturday in the presence of God. I have to spend Saturday in the presence of God. I have to fight against it. We have to pull down those passions. My dear brother, my dear sister, number one, the battlefield, you have to pull down the strongholds. They got a very strong hold in your lifestyle, in your system. If you want to be successful and if you want to be successful for Christ, somewhere you have to pull down. Otherwise you can't receive God's blessings. You can't receive God's blessings. We become lethargic. You can't afford to be lethargic to get a flight. You can't afford to be lethargic to get your train. They will not wait for you. Somehow you are fighting it out. You have to fight out your sleep. You have to plan it. You have to be there 1.5 hours early. You have to be there 1.5 hours early. Then you plan accordingly. But God's presence is counted contempt. So the blessings will also proportionate to that. You honor Him, He will honor you. That He said, draw nigh unto me, I will draw nigh unto you. You honor Him, He will honor you. If I am your Father, where is my honor? The Lord says. My dear brother, my dear sister, pull down. Be hard. You have to pull down that structure of not honoring God. Not honoring God with your substance. Not honoring God with your lifestyle. Pull down that. My dear brother, my dear sister, I'll go quickly. Number two. Casting down imaginations. Casting down imaginations. The word imagination, Greek, make a note of it. Number two. Logismos. 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 From this word only we get the word logistics. Logic. Logic. Logismos means reasoning. Reasoning. The simple meaning is reasoning. It's not just imagination. And the logismos, the meaning is that we get logarithms. Logismos means computation. Kanakapurra. Computation. That we get computer. Reasoning. Logic. Logic. You have got reasoning. You have got a lot of reason. That is the reason you are unable to pull down the strongholds. The another battlefield is your own logic, your own philosophy, your own reasonings. Why are you doing like this? You have got a lot of reason. Why are you not going to the church? I am sick. There are so many people come to the church because they are sick. They come for prayer. And it's very interestingly, the unbeliever comes to the church for prayer and the believer doesn't come to the church. The unbeliever comes to the church, unbelieving sick person comes to the church for prayer and the believing sick person will lie in the house. He doesn't believe in the prayer. He doesn't believe in the prayer. I am sick. I am tired. Only this morning I have come down. Only this morning I reached Chennai. How can I come straight? I'll come for the evening service. I'll attend the evening service. There's a reason. And a Pandraj can give a reason. I'll come for the evening service. I'll come to the second service. He can give a reason. My dear brother, my dear sister, fighting against the reasons. They got a reason. Glory be to the Lord's Holy, a computation, a calculation in various systems of false philosophies, false doctrines. They got a reason, false teachings. I know one person very strong in the seer side. When we talk about baptism, only one reason till this day she gives. Enga bishop ku theriyadha. She has got a reason. You have got your own man-made reasons. My dear brother, my dear sister. Yesterday we were talking about a servant of God, a husband and wife. There were a lot of changes in their ministry area. The church where they were assisting, they are not very comfortable. They don't feel the spirit move. And somebody asked them, then why can't you think about going elsewhere? You can pray. You've got a reason. சாகிற வரைக்கும் இங்கே தான் இருக்கும். சப்போஸ் தே டோட்டலி சேஞ்ச் த ஃபிலாசபி, த சேஞ்ச் த டாக்ட்ரின், கெட் தேர் ஒன்லி திங், சாகிற வரைக்கும் இங்கே தான் இருக்கும். We have got reason why we want to do like this. Why can't we follow the word of God? Enga appa setta pera nyanasthan eduthukuren. We got a reason. Enga madathil irukka andha lechakanakana janangalna muttaalgala. You got a reason. Those are worshipping idols. All are they fools? But you Christians also got idols. What is wrong in it? It's only a representation. We are not worshipping that idol. We are venerating. Wordplay. We are only venerating. You have got a lot of reasons why you can't obey the word of God. Why you can't come to the faith. Why are you doing this? Why are you living a life against the strong doctrine of the word? Our idea about success. Our philosophies. Our concepts, we have to fight against all these things, my dear brother, my dear sister. You have to fight against stronghold, you have to fight against imaginations, reasonings, logics, your own philosophies, darkangal. You've got your own dargam. Why are you doing like this? Why are you not getting up in time? You have got an argument. You have got a reason for that. As long as you give weightage to the reason, you cannot be successful. Don't be a slave to the reason. Don't be a slave to the reason. Rise up to the occasion. There's a battle to fight. Why are you not studying? There's a reason. Why are you playing? There is a reason. Why are you not obeying? There is a reason. The cause and the effect. If that reason is not a sound biblical principle, the effect of that cause will be hilarious. My dear brother, my dear sister, today it's a very powerful message to you. The Lord is giving you. We have to pull down strongholds and casting down imaginations, reasonings, false teachings, doctrines, our own pride, our own prejudice. Now we can't do this. I can't do that. I can't be a slave. Oh, why should I obey pastor? Is he a boss? I got every reason. And these are the reasons. Certain reasons are because of the pride in us. Certain reasons are because of the prejudice in us. We have to cast those imaginations or logics, logismos. Otherwise you can't be successful. If I want to give reason, I can give reason. Everybody can give reason. I remember one incident, very quickly I say that. When I was working in Sishya, one day I was very late. There was some bus problem. I was very late. And as I was getting into the compound, the headmaster came. It was Mr. McKenzie. The headmaster came. So he was coming, I was going in. I knew very well he would ask me why I was late. And I want to tell him the reason why I was late. So we are just, I was ready with a reason when I knew very well he would ask me. So he, when he saw me, he said, "Hey, Robert, morning." I said, "Morning, Mr. McKenzie." "Go, go, go." I just stopped to say the reason. He said, "Go, go, go." He didn't ask me why I was late. So in the interval, he met me. He said, "Hey, Robert, what happened? Why are you late?" I asked Mr. McKenzie. Mr. McKenzie, why didn't you ask me in the morning when you met me? Why didn't you ask me in the morning when you met me? He said, hey, Robert, I know you're an intelligent fellow. You will give one reason certainly. Will you be without any reason? Whether a right reason or wrong reason, you will give a reason. You are an intelligent fellow. Now I am asking out of courtesy. What happened? Why are you late? Brother, sister, for all your evils, for all your wrongdoings, all your slipshots, you want to give a reason, you can give a reasoning. And the best reasoning, what we learned 6,000 years ago in the Garden of Eden, it is because of her. Why are you late? It is because of her. You ask her, why are you late? It is because of the serpent. It is because of something else. That's what I said. We have got these type of strongholds for 6,000 years. We have got these strongholds for 6,000 years. Not yesterday. Our reasonings. My dear brother, my dear sister, our habits, our customs, our reasoning, and the third one, again in verse 5. I know some people are praying, let pastor finish very fast. I don't know what all the things he's going to show to us who we are. If there's a real mirror that can show to us who we are, how horrible it would be. We all want to appear glamorous for the camera. We don't want anybody to see the who. The real who we are. Number 3. Casting down every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. Casting down. You have to cast down every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. High thing. The Greek word, make a note of it. Hupsoma. I'm not putting a mantra. The Greek word, H-O-O-P, hoop, S-O-S-O-M-A, M-A-H, hoopsoma. From the word hoop, we get the word heap. Heap, huvian, made. That word hoopsoma means exalted, an exalted position. A very high opinion. That's against the knowledge of God. At times it's hyper-ego. That's a mental problem. Ego, I know who I am. Hyper-ego, I think more than who I am. I think I am a king. I am a queen. Hyper-ego, thinking more than who we are. At times even the ego, I know who I am. An exalted opinion. Every high thing. There are many high things. Paul had many high things. They were against the knowledge of the excellency of God. The excellency of the knowledge of Christ. Christuve arigira arivin menmai. The knowledge of the excellency of Christ. Knowing Christ. The knowledge of Christ. There are a lot of things. Knowing Christ. Being one with Christ. Being one with Christ. Adam knew Eve, Cain was born. God knows us, Christ will be born. We know Christ, we know God, His nature will be born. There's knowing. Because of the coming together, something is born, that's knowledge. Being one with God, that something is born good. Christ is born. A divine nature is born. There are certain exalted opinions about ourselves. We are unable to pull down that. I told you, I show you an example from the Bible. There was a king's man. His son was sick. He was a king's man. His son was sick. So he came fell at the feet of Jesus. Jesus was a village preacher. His exalted position as a king's man, didn't stop him to fall at the feet of a village preacher. My dear brother, my dear sister, certain times the exalted thinking about ourselves, the high opinion about ourselves, when some paisa comes, when the business flourishes, I am so and so. We have to pull down these high opinions about ourselves. We think high about ourselves. There are many reasons. I got a few things noted down. Every exalted opinion respecting the dignity and purity of human nature. I am pure. I am holy. I am not like that man. I am not like that sister. I'm not behaving like that. My past was not like that. Because of your purity, because of your dignity, you come from a dignified family. We have got ever so many reasons why we have got very high opinions. The pride of the human heart and of the understanding. The pride of the human heart and your understanding. To be very brief, I tell you, your knowledge, your education, your racial difference, I belong to this caste, he belongs to that caste. The racial difference, financial difference, sociological difference, so many things make you feel that you are higher above somebody else. You're higher above somebody else. You have to pull down that, cast down that. Otherwise you can't have union with Christ, the knowledge of God. So Paul says, I counted all those kupsomas, kuppa. All those kupsomas, kuppa. They are nothing but dung, refuse. Nothing but refuse. No use. Unless I'm able to count those high things about me. Oh, I am very good. What then? My dear brother, my dear sister. There was a family. They had a very ordinary scooter. In a jocular way, I know that some of the believers called that scooter Kailangada scooter. Came, the Lord blessed them abundantly, blessed them financially, blessed their business, and they got a beautiful, lovely car. We are very happy about their success. But their nature, that air, that look, that walk, changed dramatically when it was shifted from a Kailangada scooter to a car. Everybody should greet them. Everybody should inquire them. If they are sick, pastor should be in their house the next minute. That yeah, my dear brother, my dear sister. So even the husband and wife, oh, I have studied more. I am from a rich family. You have got reason. You are able to be in a higher plateau. But if that is against the knowledge of God, that is against for you to have a Christian nature, you have to cast it down. My dear brother, my dear sister, I say one more thing before I conclude and lead you to pray. It's very, very important message. Entertaining vain and unfounded opinions of respecting their own excellencies, all these things, self-righteousness, I am unable to go through all the points. Number four, casting down. Number four, bringing into captivity every thought, and he says every thought to the obedience of Christ. Bringing into captivity every thought. What do you mean by this every thought? Here also I give you the Greek word, you make a note of it. Noema. Noema means perception, how we see. I may have a wrong perception. In our psychology we have studied, there are different types of wrong perceptions. We perceive it in a wrong way. There are different types of wrong perceptions. A boy and a girl are standing and talking, we get a perception. A man and woman are standing and talking, we get a perception. We get a perception, noema, a perception. We get a mental picture about it. Our perception, our intellect, immediately my mind suggests, well, this boy and the girl, why are they talking like this? I get a connection, I'm able to reason it, intellect. Disposition. I put things together. The word thought, what is translated as noema, means our perception, our intellect, our disposition. We got three types of wrong perception. One is a very ordinary wrong perception. We call it illusion. You are going in a train and you see all the trees are going in the opposite direction. It will be so for Annan, it will be so for Pastor Ma, it will be so for Simon, it will be so for me. We all will perceive the trees are traveling in the wrong direction. It's an illusion. There are a lot of illusions. Everybody will mistake like that. Everybody will have a wrong perception like that. And the second wrong perception, we call the delusion. There is a rope lying down. Somebody in the night, oh, there is a snake. There is a reason. There is a rope. But for somebody's eyes, that rope will seem to be a snake. For others, they say, no, it's only a rope. No, it's only a snake. It's a wrong perception. There is a reason for that perception. And the strongest mental disorder of perception, wrong perception, is hallucination. There is no rope. Nobody sees a rope there. There is no rope. Still you could see a snake. Illanga or snake irukku. Anga yaro nikkranga. Anga yaro, nobody will be standing there. It's a wrong perception. We have got a lot of perception like this. We have got our own viewpoints. We are very strong that is right, whether that's right or wrong, we have got a very strong viewpoint that is right. I perceive it like that. But why you say that's wrong? That's wrong. There's nothing wrong in it. No, that's wrong. Because their perception, they perceive that is wrong. There is no biblical stand. There is no spiritual stand to say why that is wrong. Maybe different reasons. Maybe their culture, the way they have brought up, their psychology, their inner mind, or they may be a mental disorder. So many reasons. But they got a wrong perceptions. Wrong viewpoints. You have to bring down that to the obedience of Christ. Now what are these wrong viewpoints? Just as I say that, why should you take baptism? You get a lot of things. Your stronghold, your logic, and your reasoning. There's nothing wrong in it. It's said in like this in the Bible. You see Rebecca. You see it's in Isaiah. Their perception. Why should you take baptism? Why should you do this? Why should you do that? Wow, I can't. எல்லாம் பைபிள் எல்லாம் இருக்கு, என்ன பைபிள் இருக்க மாதிரி எல்லாம் நடந்துடுறாங்க. A perception. My dear brother, my dear sister, you have battleground. You have to pull down every stronghold. You have to cast down every imagination, every logic. You have to cast down every high opinion that exalted against the knowledge of God. You have to cast it down. And you have to bring down, control it, subdue. The word bring down is bring to submission. Control it. Don't allow that to rule over you. Bring down every thought, every noema, every perception, your intellectual interpretation of the word of God. I just say this, I'm unable to swallow it. Many years back, a great intellectual person, an intellectual giant who thoroughly 27 languages. He was a professor in Usmania University, a Muslim. When he was teaching comparative studies of religion, he found salvation is by faith. So he went through a lot of persecution. He escaped from that. And he was going from place to place as with a quest. And his strong argument is man is saved by faith, not by works. They're saved by grace, not by works. So he had come to Chennai. Somebody has told him about me. It's the time that I came for the full-time ministry. I was assisting Pastor Sundaramaya. So he came to see me and he was discussing things with me and suddenly asked me, you believe that our salvation is totally by grace, not by works? I said, yes, sir. He said, have you taken immersion baptism? I said, yes, sir. He asked me, if salvation is by grace, taking immersion baptism, still are you not depending on works? Still are you not depending on works? Our salvation is only by grace, by the finished work of Jesus on the cross of Calvary, not by our baptism. I said, sir, 100% I agree with you. I don't believe any mystic power in baptism. I told him, I remember what Ingersoll said. By dipping a pig into the water, we can't take a pup out. I said, yes, you are right. By dipping a pig into the water, we can't take a pup out. I said, yes, nevertheless, my intelligence says that's wrong. But my Jesus took that baptism and my Jesus said, believe and be baptized. So even my intelligence is madness before his intelligence. He has asked me to do something what is really good for me. So I have done it, though my intelligence doesn't agree with me. Immediately he got up. He said, give me baptism now. I want to obey. And I said, by that I declare my God is right and I am wrong. By doing that seems to be foolish to me. By doing that which has got no meaning to me. By getting into the water and coming out of the water, it has got nothing to do with me. But I do it because my master has said, I declare he is right and I am wrong. Immediately he stood up and said, oh, give me baptism now. I said, sir, I am under a pastor, so I cannot take a decision. My pastor has to do it. But you obey the Lord in baptism. It's not that I should baptize you. With that conviction, he left. His perception was pulled down. He was ready to bring down his perception. His perception about salvation. His perception about baptism, the fitting example. Pull it down. Pull it down. Bring it to subjection. We have got a battle to fight. Our weapons are not carnal. Our weapons are mighty through God. Our weapons are mighty through God. Mighty through God for what? To pull down the strongholds, our habits, our customs, 6,000-year-old nature. Pull down. Cast down all reasoning, logics, your own computations, Cast it down. Cast it down. Your own logics. Every high thinking. Every exalted thing about you. Cast it down. Every wrong perception. Every wrong viewpoint. Your intellectual reasonings. Bring down to submission. You'll have victory. And what are the weapons? How can I bring down? What are the weapons? Bulldozer. What are the cannonballs? Bombs I should use to bring down these strongholds. To cast down these imaginations and the high thinking. How can I do it? What are the weapons? They are the weapons of might. They are weapons of might. God willing. We'll have a meditation on the weapons of might later. Shall we close our eyes? Surely that will help you, that will make this complete. But take a decision today. Take a decision today. I will pull down all strongholds. The Lord wants to give you victory. The Lord wants to give you victory. Unless you decide to pull down these strongholds, these imaginations, these high thinkings, you cannot have victory. The Lord promises you His victory. Hallelujah. Shall we pray?